Hey, Sashan, what's going on? Crispy's got something to say.
I emphasized something more in my game this week that I think I will do more of in the future. And that is, I used characters under my control to give player characters more information about the world, but not explicitly so, not with some kindly gentleman walking up and giving this lengthy exposition about the entire history of the railroad in this town. No, nothing like that. We had a combat encounter, a fairly significant combat encounter in our session this week. And what I used is I used this is going to sound a little morbid, but I used the NPCs under my control to show the monster's special abilities. So one of the NPCs, an ally of the party, gets snatched by the monster and thrown into this fiery portal, screaming the whole way. Another, we'll say not an ally, but a fellow combatant, gets smashed to bits with another attack from this monster. And I describe that rather than saying, because what I want to avoid is I want to avoid players saying, I want to make a check to know how much I know about these monsters. Rather than do that, I'm encouraging players to use their imagination more, because I think using our imagination is going to result in a much better experience. And my hope is, as I encourage players to use their imagination and I describe what is happening to those around them, then they can fill in the blanks. And in some cases, of course, I will be forthcoming if a player's background knows, if they know something about this, or it would make sense they'd know something about that. But I'm encouraging that to come not driven by me, but driven by the players themselves, as they take that initiative and say, no, that it would make sense I would know this about. And it's okay if they get it wrong, because maybe their character thinks that they know something about it. And this particular example.
Oh, here we go. NPCs might not know everything. So, unreliable narration, that's what I use.
Example of creature, opponent, hazard is slightly different. It's not going to be, it might be similar to what they thought they knew, but this one's unique. So it worked well in the sense that it wasn't me just saying, ah, it has a breath weapon. Ah, it has a wing attack. Oh, it can crush things. It can grab. It can banish you to hell.
In the movie, Nope, Jean's jacket's flying around, right? You don't really see how the monster kills people until people are inside the monster. I think it sucked people up or something. And then, what is it, like, digested the people and then spit out their bones and crap through its nostrils or something like that. I like this background he's got. It's pretty cool.
Rather than describing that as an abstract concept, I think displaying it in the world in action is way more dynamic. And it worked well. It worked well in a com so as I'm trying to role play more in combat encounters, in order for the combat encounter to feel dynamic and keep it moving along quickly, it does help with the pacing and the tension in the game. When there's the players, like the ally that's just standing right next to you, is all of a sudden just misted, and where all that's left is one cowboy boot, and everything else is gone.
Like in X-Men, Cyclops wears the thing over his eyes. People new to the comic are like, why does he wear that thing on his face all the time? And then you see him take it off and brrr, ruby laser, whatever, coming. Is oh, okay, that's why he. And then he puts it back on. He closes his eyes, he has to close his eyes, he puts it back on. You showed, show the audience, show the players, show the whatever, what, have the NPC do stuff within you know, in proximity to the players. Don't have the NPC doing this stuff like during their alone time. No, have the NPCs do things in sight, in line of sight, in plain view almost with the characters. The characters see some strange looking dude. It's like, why is the dude chained up like that? Or why is he kept in a box? Or why is he on display up on stage, chained up? What's his deal? What does he do? Let the players see. You know, the players, they don't stay the whole time, but the time they're there, they get to see a glimpse of what the NPC can do, what the monster can do. So when they have to deal with it later, they kind of have an idea. Uh-oh, this guy again. Or you can, I guess you can do the reveal during a fight scene later on with the thing. That's when they find out. You know, that's when they find out what it can do. But usually you have a, I have a twist ending for that. So I let the players know ahead of time so they can prepare. They go and get, they get what they need. They get what they think they're going to need. And it works for the most part, but there's a twist. Remember Master Blaster?
And then players start to really start worrying about survival. Because at the end of the, almost inevitably, when I get feedback from players of sessions that were, how should I say this? Let's call it exceptional or left an impression. It's usually sessions where it was questionable whether or not everyone would survive or anyone would survive. So the game sessions where it's more about surviving instead of just checking off, just doing fetch quests or things like that. It's always, there's some perilous thing that's happened.
Yeah. I never remember a fetch quest. Either I don't do them or I just don't remember them. Normally in the game, years later, I'll still remember like with Fallout 3, the ghouls want ten penny tower. I always say pen tenny, I don't know why. Ten penny tower. And ten penny wants the ghouls dead. And you're thinking, no matter which side you help as a player character, no matter which side you side with and help, things go wrong, things go bad. And that's what I like in a game session, is where no matter what you do, things are going to happen the way they're going to happen, but in a different way. There's no good guy. You're in the, I guess you're in the right place at the wrong time, sort of thing. Wrong place at the right time. You can, you're trying your best to solve a situation, no matter what you do. It's just, you know, that kind of thing.
Putting.
And that's just one of many game sessions you remember, stuff like that. You're not gonna remember stuff like, oh, we had a quick rest. Has anyone else done any more fixed D&D 5e videos? Kind of. Maybe there's something to say about D&D 5e if people keep making videos on how to fix it.
That I think results in more memorable experiences. Other thing I wanted to give an update on.
Even Pundit has videos on how to fix D&D 5e, and he was a consultant for the game rules.
I talked in a previous video briefly about my struggles with downtime and how to handle downtime. I'm staying with it. I want to get better at doing this. And so I did do this big event happened, this big climax that we had worked up to. And then I did go around the table and we did use that, what I showed in a previous video, where we borrowed the interlude system, and it worked surprisingly well. One thing that it did do, though, is it did cause some of my players to say, you know, I think I'm going to need a new character. I think this particular character, he's had his hero's journey. He's had his story arc. I'm comfortable where it is for now. And if I'm comfortable with where it is for now, perhaps the thing to do is to introduce someone new. And I thought that was great. So it was not something I was aiming for. I wasn't trying to do the interludes to just retire.
That's cool. I like it when players realize these kinds of things.
Player characters, because, you know, it's time for new blood. But that is what happened, at least in one instance, where the player had already told me, you know, I think I'm getting to the end of this particular character, and it probably makes sense for me to start thinking about someone else. And of course, now I am trying to think of conflicts, introduce conflicts, and then have organically improvised conflicts that pose significant peril. So death is very much on the table, and that does also mean that we have a high.
Yeah. Sometimes I've had players where they will do a one shot, and then we vote on, hey, let's do this again in another one shot. And at the end of that one shot, one of the players might realize, I'm not going with you guys. I'm staying. I'm staying with these people. Because the character may have fallen in love with some NPC or something, likes the new surroundings, likes the planet, likes the farmland, the easy, simple life. And then that player gets to make a new character. Maybe they're from the farmland or from the other planet, and they want to join these guys. You know, they want to do the traveling and all that kind of stuff. They want to go on adventure. So it gives I guess that would be our way of players parking, parking a character somewhere and then making a new character for this new situation that's going to happen. Which makes sense. Instead of having the same character for years kind of a thing, you know, that doesn't make any sense to me. Because then you're just, what are you doing? It gets boring if you're role-playing the same character over and over and over. You know, Yul Brynner, maybe he could role-play the King and I, whatever, forever. I don't know, 5,000 shows he did, 6,000 shows he did. That would be boring as heck. Doing not only role playing the same character, but the same story, same dance routines. Oh no!
Higher turnover of player characters. The heroes come and go quite regularly, and I think that's not uncommon in Dungeon Crawl Classics games. I think that's to be expected, and not just in funnels. Funnels are, of course, what everyone thinks of for DCC. And we've run a number of funnels, and players typically do like funnels. If you're not familiar with the concept, every player starts with four peasants. And really peasants. Like these are cannon fodder in every sense of the word. And after the funnel, anyone who's still breathing could potentially become a level one character. It's something that is... I would say, much like in other systems, they become known for one or two components of the system, even if those aren't the main.
Yeah, I talked about this recently with players. This funnel idea, should we use it? Should we use a one shot as a funnel? And the characters that make it through, we then do more one shots with these characters? And they said no. To them, the funnel is the thing. After the funnel, you retire your character. That's how they see it. Which I thought, okay. So technically my one shots are funnels. I mean, they are in a way. The characters start out semi-healthy, semi-rational at the beginning of the one shot, and then we see who gets less insane as the session goes, and who gets more insane as the session, role reversal type stuff can happen in my games.
Component of the system. And I would argue that as much as funnels can be fun, I think DCC is a better game beyond the funnel. I think that Weird Frontiers is a fantastic game, and it would be a shame if it was just, we run a funnel, a Western funnel in it. I think you...
Oh, yeah, like with Traveler. Oh, my character died during character generation. I've heard people just skip over the funnel part with DCC. I don't know if that's still a thing. Now, DCC's gone through several iterations, so I don't know if it's still using the original rules that Goodman did back in the day.
It would leave way too much on the table. In fact, as a bit of a tangent, I was talking to the players and how I'm becoming more and more disillusioned with the reward being experience points. And I'm more interested in everyone deciding what kind of game, what kind of power level, what kind of, if you want to play a more powerful characters that have had significant experiences already in life, can't we just start at that level? We don't necessarily have to grow.
I want to say it's an age-old question, but no one asks that question. Can we just start at level 10? Is there a rule that says, no, you must start at level 0? You will. Oh, yes. For this game to operate properly, you will start at level 0. Whenever I bring it up, the fanatics out there go, that's heresy. Their eyes glaze over when I even suggest such a thing. Zero to hero. You start as heroes? Yeah, basically.
Grind our way all the way through for years and years. And we've done that. I have run games like that. We start at level 1 and then eventually we retire at level 20. I have done that. It can be a bit of a slog. And the problem with it is that it becomes, character death becomes so taboo that the game system that employ that kind of progression, they also tend to have multiple ways of bringing characters back from the brink. And I'm not as convinced that results in the most memorable experiences. Oh, well, this is just the seven.
No, there's the bingo players, the character sheet players, they want all the, what is it called? All the trophies, the trophy players. They want all the stuff. They want to fill in their character sheet so they can say they've done a complete thing, like the Boy Scout. They want to be the Boy Scout with all the merit badges. They want to be that guy. So their character gets all the merit badges, all the gold stars, all the trophies, all the letters in bingo. They want to win the game. And it's like, no, not an ounce of role play occurs with those kinds of players. Like scavenger hunt. Back in the day, back in the 80s, we called them scavenger hunt players. Yep. I don't know if it was an Indiana Jones thing, looking for treasure constantly. Or a museum, they want to fill up a museum of relics. The museum needs this relic and this relic. Skyrim suffers from that too, with its trophy rooms you can add to the game.
17th time that I've been resurrected in this game session. I mean, yeah, it cost me a lot of gold, or, you know, whatever it is, 1,000 gold piece or 5,000 gold piece diamonds.
Make it so that when your character's resurrected, they're not quite the same person. I mean, it's hard to do. If you don't have role players in your group, it's impossible to do. Some people think, oh, player agency, you're messing with my player agency, man.
But it's just it's like a tax. I just have to pay the tax and then I can keep going. That feels a little
exactly taxi. Yeah. You go outside, a bum is gonna mug you unless you give him everything you own. That's called tax.
A little shallow to me now. I'd much prefer to have something that's deadly. Okay, we started at level 5 instead of level 1, but you die. Like, that's, and then we go on to your character's gone. You're going to have to make a new one, and we'll see how well you can keep this one alive, if at all. So the fast forward.
Usually what happens is when a character dies and they're resurrected, guess what happens? For the rest of the games, for the rest of the campaign, for the most part, it just becomes a comedy. Because especially if someone's trying to roleplay their character differently after being resurrected, the other players who don't roleplay, they're going to make fun of the character and point out the differences. I like the before Karen, not the after Karen, you know, that kind of thing. It just turns into that. Like, was it Star Trek? They go find Spock and they bring him back to Earth in the 80s to find some whales now. And they dress Spock up like a Hare Krishna. It just becomes a big joke. It's just a huge joke. Oh, Spock's alive, but you know, make him into a huge ass joke. I want to say all of the characters were bumbling idiots in that episode of Star Trek. You know, make the nerds happy.
It actually did work well. I did a year this time. I said, what happened over the course of this last year? Describe what happened with your character since this major event. There's other things that have gone on. Tell us about what those are. The other thing that's good about this is that it encourages players to use their imagination. And this is a bit of a struggle.
That's weird. They should always be using their imagination, right? If they're in character. Imaginary character all the time.
Well, because if we're not practicing using imagination, then that's something that's I'm struggling with, and I'm not sure that there is an answer for this. If you really want to turn a game around like I do and dive deep into the role play aspect of it, there is an underlying assumption that all of us have exercised the imagination enough that we can think of things. We can imagine ourselves and in this setting. And it's not just,
yeah, just affix a well, maybe not for you, but for me, a quick fix for that is to talk in dialogue. All the players talk in character to each other using dialogue. Just dialogue, just ordinary dialogue, just practice ordinary dialogue. It's a chapter I'm adding to my book. You know, just instead of do what your character would do, it's what my character would do, you know. Say what your character would say. Then you don't even have to do the thing like, my character's doing this. My character Jones is gonna do, you know. I have a habit of saying, I'm gonna. So I'm like, fuck it. Just do dialogue. Because in dialogue, you can say stuff like, I'm gonna. I'm gonna beat your brains in. Instead of saying, my character's gonna bash his brains in. Just do it. Just say in dialogue. Just do the whole thing in dialogue. Then you're not even thinking, am I imagining my character properly? You're not even thinking that because you're too busy in dialogue with other characters. So that's what I have found has worked in the last, I don't know, 4 weeks, 3 weeks.
Just ourselves imagining it, but we can imagine what other people, like, so as they describe it, I can picture in my mind, or I can think that description that my player over here has said, I can contextualize that in my understanding of the world, and the resolution might not be so high that we know exactly how the architecture is. We're not all, what I'm saying is that we're not all picturing the fiction completely the same, but we have...
Oh no, you don't want everyone, yeah, unless they're seeing pictures of everything. No, everyone has a totally different view. Like this picture behind you, it's got yellow sky. How come the sky's not pinkish? The clouds are sort of this brown, light brownish color. Why aren't they light bluish? Why isn't the sky light bluish? How come this part of the sky isn't already dark purple? You know, is the sun on the horizon? Is it touching the horizon? Is it halfway on the horizon? When you say the sun is setting, what color is the sun? Is it orange, yellow, white still? One of them Star Wars blue color stars. Just say the bare minimum. The players will fill in the rest with imagination. They're not going to compare notes, are they? They're not going to. The handrails were made of oak. No, they were made of mahogany. No, it's pine. The doorknob, was it brass? Silver? Iron, plastic. When you say flashing lights, do you have to say which color the lights are? The button. Push the button. Is the button gray color, black color, blue color, red color? Each player is going to envision what that, like the brushed metal. The DeLorean has, the body is brushed metal, brushed aluminum, something like that. People might know what that looks like. But over time, they might start thinking, what color is the car again? Is this black or blue or is it yellow? Or they're trying to remember what a DeLorean even looked like. But if you show them a picture of one, they're like, oh, okay. Then they all know exactly what it looks like. Show them what the door is opening. Then they know even more. Oh, that car. Yeah. Now, they might not know that when you sit in the car, your legs are best basically stretched out in front of you. You're almost laying on your back, kind of a thing. Anyway, maybe they won't even be in the car, so they won't have to imagine what that's like being in a DeLorean. But each player, someone undoubtedly always says, I'm going to sit in the back. There's no back in a DeLorean. But someone's always going to say, I'm going to be in the back seat. Because that's how they imagine it in their head.
Have enough imagination to fill in the gaps, and I'm wondering if there's methods of practicing imagination. I suspect that most of us start off pretty good with
People with high IQs just assume everyone does this. It's our fault.
Imagining things. And then over time, we become jaded, or we don't use that, we don't have that creative outlet anymore, perhaps, and we drift away from.
I remember this is what, back in 2015, I think. I went to a job interview, and the guy, he says, "Oh, let's do a little role play." And I'm like, "Oh, cool, I like role play." He wanted me to role play what my character would be doing when such and such happens at the company. And he didn't like my character. So he was like, "Thank you for your time." I was laughing. I always thought that was so funny. I mean, that's a good way to interview people real quick to find out if they're a good fit for a company or not. Because I don't know. To me, the company's a black box. I don't know anything about the company. I have no idea what they even do. And it was interesting. I don't think he never did find a person who had the right answer for his company without saying what his company even is. And that they're gone. Within a year, I think they all went bankrupt over there.
Imagining, and we're just way too grounded in the material. Oh, I can see it. I have to see the grid. I have to see the miniature. I have to see the picture. I have to have it in my senses. I can't just conjure it in my mind. But I think that the ability to imagine is going to be so incredibly important as we enter into this.
Well, what I do with new players, I ask them about the movies they watch or the books they read. I ask them, what's your favorite movie? What part did you like the best? And if they can say, if they're like this, you know, snappy answers to stupid questions kind of thing, then they're on the ball. If they sit there and go, favorite movie, I'm like, thank you for your time. But if they're answering the question before I finish, like, what is your favorite movie? And they're like, Planet of the Apes. What part did you like in that movie? Who's your favorite character? Or what's your favorite scene in that movie? If they can remember dialogue from the movie, they're hired. It's like, okay, they can think in terms of cinematics. They imagine what they're doing as a movie. They can do dialogue on the fly. They don't go, I think I'll try a yap. No, they don't do that. But if they're like Leon, if it's like Leon in Blade Runner, what's a tortoise? You know, that's the problem.
Pretend world. We have to be able to imagine. We have to be able to suspend that disbelief and imagine, no, what if this was really the case? What if this really worked? So anyway, that's my that's some thoughts that I had on the importance I don't know, I think I just lost my video for a second there. I'm trying a different camera setup and we'll see how it works. Love to have your feedback on this, and I appreciate you taking the time.
That was cool. Gotta upload now.